Today we are going to discuss conceptual questions of chapter number 12, current electricity. Question number 1. Why it is not possible to measure the drift speed for electron by timing their travel along a conductor? Answer. The average speed acquired by the electron in application of some field is called its drift speed. We have discussed drift speed in our previous lecture, and we know that when we apply field at the ends of a conductor, the electrons in a conductor acquire drift speed. In general, the speed is defined as the distance covered per unit time. But here in this case, the drift speed is too small, and above general method is not accurate in this case. The electrons move randomly in a conductor when no potential difference is applied. And when the conductor is connected to a voltage source, the electrons start moving in a proper direction due to electric field produced by the source. The electrons collide with lattice atom and follow the zigzag path with varying speed. So the electrons do not cover appreciable distance in time t. That is why we cannot measure the drift velocity of electrons by timing their travel along a conductor. As we have discussed in previous lecture, that there are free electrons in a conductor that move randomly. But when we apply electric field, when we connect this conductor to a voltage source, electrons start moving in a proper direction due to electric field, and they have drift speed. Due to applied electric field, the electrons experience a force in a direction opposite to electric field. Due to collision of electrons, they do not cover appreciable distance in time t. That's why it is not possible to measure the drift speed for electron by timing their travel along a conductor. Question number 2. The relationship R is equals to V divided by I tells us that the resistance of a conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference applied to it. What do you think of this proportion? Answer is no. The resistance of a given resistor is independent of applied potential difference. Explanation. According to Ohm's law, the current flow through the conductor is directly proportional to applied potential difference. Keeping the physical states remains constant, and we have V is equals to IR and R is equals to V divided by I. As according to Ohm's law, V is directly proportional to I. So here R is constant at constant temperature. It will depend on nature, dimensions, material and temperature of a conductor. As we have formula of resistance, R is equals to rho L divided by A. From this formula, it is clear that R resistance is independent of applied potential difference, and resistance depends upon the parameters resistivity, length and cross-sectional area. Hence, resistance does not depend upon applied potential difference. Question number 3. A heavy-duty battery of a truck maintains a current of 3 ampere for 24 hours. How much charge flow from the battery during this time? Given data, current is equals to I is equals to 3 amperes, and we have time t is equals to 24 hours. We can convert it into seconds, and we need to calculate the total charge flow from the battery Q. As we know that current I is equals to Q divided by T, and we have Q is equals to I into T. Putting the values, we get Q टोटल चार्ज फ्लो फ्रॉम द बैटरी क्यू इज इक्वल टू 25920 कूलम्स. क्वेश्चन नंबर 4. व्हाइल एनालाइजिंग अ सर्किट द इंटरनल रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ ईएमएफ सोर्स इज इग्नोर्ड. आंसर: इंटरनल रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ सोर्स इज ऑफन इग्नोर्ड ड्यू टू इट्स स्मॉल वैल्यू. एज वी नो दैट वैल्यू ऑफ इंटरनल रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ सोर्स इज टू स्मॉल दैट वी कैन इग्नोर इट. एक्सप्लेनेशन: इंटरनल रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ द सेल इज द रेजिस्टेंस ऑफर्ड बाय द इलेक्ट्रोलाइट ऑफ द सेल. When it is connected to an external resistor, then its EMF and terminal potential difference can be related as EMF is equals to V terminal plus IR. E is equals to I into capital R plus I into R. Here capital R is external resistor and small r is internal resistance. As internal resistance is very small, so in general E is equals to V terminal. EMF is equals to V terminal. The internal resistance of source is often ignored because its value is too small. Question number 5. Under what conditions can the terminal potential difference of a battery exceeds the EMF? Answer: terminal potential difference of the cell is greater than its EMF during its charging. Explanation: in general, we know that EMF is equals to V terminal plus I into R, or by rearranging we get V terminal is equals to EMF minus I into R. But when the battery is connected to a source of greater EMF for charging process, then reverse current flows through it. So we get V terminal is equals to EMF minus into minus IR, and V terminal is equals to E minus into minus is equals to plus. So we get here plus I into R. Hence V terminal will become greater than its EMF when the battery is connected to a source of greater EMF for charging process. Question number 6. What is the difference between an EMF and a potential difference? We already discussed this in lecture number 9, and the answer is also given here. For more understanding, listen to the lecture number 9 again. Question number 7. The loop rule is based on the conservation of energy principle and the junction rule on the conservation of charge principle. Explain just how these are based on these principles. Answer: KVL, Kirchhoff's voltage law, loop rule. It is defined as the algebraic sum of all the potential changes in a closed loop must be zero. Summation V is equal to zero. The KVL based upon the law of conservation of energy. It represents that energy supplied per unit charge by the source is equal to the energy utilized per unit charge by the various components in the circuit. So the total energy remains constant. KCL, Kirchhoff's current law or junction rule. Its statement is the sum of all currents meeting at a point or junction is equal to zero. Summation I is equal to zero. It means that the current flowing towards the point is equal to the currents flowing away from the point. It is well in according to the law of conservation of charge, where the point is neither the source nor the sink. So the total charge will remain the same. So according to KVL, energy supplied per unit charge by the source is equal to energy utilized per unit charge by the various components in a circuit. So it is based on the conservation of energy principle. According to KCL, current flowing towards the junction and You can say that the point current flowing towards the point is equals to currents flowing away from the point. So the total charge remains same. That's why this KCL is based on the conservation of charge principle. Question number 8. Why rise in temperature of a conductor is accompanied by a rise in resistance? This question is also discussed in detail in previous lectures. Answer. The resistance depends upon the temperature and the nature of material. So when the temperature of the conductor rises, the kinetic energy of the free electrons increases because electrons get more energy due to high temperature. That's why their kinetic energy also increases. The amplitude of the vibrations of atoms in the lattice increases because now electrons have greater energy. That's why their amplitude of vibration increases. The probability of collision of free electrons with lattice atoms increases because due to high temperature, electrons get higher energy, so they collide with each other. The atom will offer the bigger target. The collision of cross-section of the atoms increases. So the collision of free electrons and the atoms in the lattice become more frequent, and hence the resistance of the conductor increases. Question number 9. Does the direction of EMF provided by a battery depend on the direction of current flow through the battery? Answer. Yes. For the KVL, the direction of EMF depends upon the direction of current. If the source of EMF is traversed from negative to positive terminal, the potential change is positive. If the source of EMF traverses from positive to negative terminal, the potential change is negative. For example, the loop rule for the given circuit with clockwise current as follows: minus E1 plus E2 is equals to 0. As we have discussed Kirchhoff's voltage law in previous lecture, and from that lecture we know that direction of EMF depends upon the direction of current. In this circuit, we have chosen the direction of current as clockwise because E1 is traversed from positive terminal towards the negative terminal. That's why we have taken here minus E1. And E2 is traversed from negative to positive terminal. That's why we have taken here plus E2. According to KVL, we can sum up all the EMF and their sum is equals to 0. That's why we can sum up both EMF and we get minus E1 plus E2 is equals to 0.